I've decided to take a bit of a gamble and roll the dice on the Polaroid Cube action camera. Now, the reason I say it's a bit of a gamble is because Polaroid just isn't Polaroid anymore. A number of years ago, the company went bankrupt. The name was bought by a holding corporation, and now they're able to stick that logo on pretty much any product they fancy. They don't manufacture any of these things. They obviously import them all from China. Now, I'm not saying this in a negative way, because Polaroid now means nothing. So this could be a great camera, could be a terrible camera, but just discount the fact it says Polaroid because it doesn't mean anything. So let's find out if this is a good or a bad camera for them to stick their logo on. The Cube is available in three different colours, blue, black and red. The packaging design is particularly attractive. I think it really stands out. It's very nicely done. On the back of the box, it tells you it will record in 1080p or 720p. It will do 6 megapixel stills, so it claims. We'll test that out later on. 124 degree wide-angle lens and magnetic, and that really seems to attract people's attention. Flipping magnets, how do they work? We'll talk about that a little bit more later on. Now, inside the box, there's the instruction booklet in the top, little thing that holds it in place, and there's the camera at the bottom. As you can see, magnetically attached to that base, and this little tiny USB charging lead, data transfer lead, with a micro B on there. Very nice little lead there. I'm going to use that from now on for other things. That metal bit on the bottom, obviously, stuck to the magnet on the bottom of the camera there. Quite a strong magnet, but perhaps not strong enough to hold it to things if you're doing crazy stunts, but I'll talk more about that later on. Got these plastic protection things on here to stop it getting scraped up in the box, I suppose. Now, if you look very closely around the lens, you'll see it says full HD video, 1080p, 124 degree wide-angle lens, and on the other side it says weatherproof. So not waterproof, weatherproof. Basically, if it gets out in the rain, it should be all right. So there's your magnet on the bottom, slight indent on there. One button on the top with an LED in front of it. And below the lens on the front of the camera, you've got a tiny hole there. That's the microphone hole. If we spin it round on the back, if we open this up with a coin, that's where the insides are, of course. We've got 720p, 1080p switch in there, the charging data transfer USB micro B socket and a micro SD card slot in there. Now, looking in the instruction booklets, which are in multiple languages, very simple booklet, just basically gets you up and running, not much else. There's a few things I've found out, well, maybe one thing I found out that isn't mentioned anywhere in this booklet, but I'll talk about that a little bit later on. So as far as getting inside the back of this, it tells you the micro SD card you put in, it recommends you should use a class 10 card. Conveniently, I've got one of those to hand, so I'll just put that in the back of the camera. Now, you put the contacts facing upwards. It's a spring-loaded slot. Just push it in there, click it into place. Notice the plastic cap is attached to the bottom of the camera there. Inside there, there must be a little bit of metal just to hold it to that magnet on the bottom, which is a clever idea. It means you're not going to lose it when you take it off. Now, this camera is one of those ones when you tap the button, it won't come on. You have to hold it down for a couple of seconds, and it'll beep at you to say that it's come on, and the light comes on as well. Now, to take a photo, a still, just tap the button, it flashes red and takes a still. So that's how you take a still photo. I'll just show you again. There you go. Now you want to get it to start video, double tap, and now you can see the red light's flashing and it's recording video. And when you want to stop the video from recording, just a single tap stops it. And then if you want to power it down, you hold down the button and the camera powers off. It's a very intuitive system. It's great how they've got that into one button. I've had some one button cameras in the past that don't make any sense. This one, very easy to understand how to operate. Now we'll just have a look at some sample footage that I shot with the camera. YouTube always messes these clips up a little bit, which is the reason why I always have downloadable clips available on my website, and a link to that is in the video description. But as far as looking at them on YouTube goes, they still look pretty good. This is 1080p first of all. Notice it's a good wide angle, a good field of view, 124 degrees, but it's not ridiculous. It doesn't make things look too fisheye or too much barrel distortion. That's 1080p. Let's move over to 720p. Look at the top left. Notice the logo, the timestamp thing, got larger in 720p, but that's pretty much the only real noticeable difference. The quality's still there, still a decent quality image, perhaps just a bit softer than 1080p. By the way, you can turn that timestamp off. I'll show you that later on. Now I'll hold it in my hand, do a bit of walking around. Notice how shaky it is. It's a very small thing, very hard to hold it steady, and there's no stabilization on it. But I'll just be quiet for a moment so you can have a listen to the sound quality from the camera. Georgia. Now, other than the shot right at the beginning when I showed you the 720p mode, everything else in this video has been shot in 1080p. Now, your choices are 720p30 or 1080p30. Notice the logo, the timestamp, isn't on at the top left there. That's because I've switched that off in the menus. I'll show you how you do that later on. Now, the bitrate for 1080p and 720p is identical, strangely enough. So that means there's less bitrate to go around in 1080p, so in fast-moving scenes you might find that they block up a little bit more, and that might be a reason to switch to 720p. But I've shot everything that you'll see in this video from here on in the 1080p mode. One thing I did notice, it's quite hard sometimes to get the camera pointing straight because it's so small. Getting the horizon straight is quite difficult, and also it's quite hard to hold it steady because, again, of its size. Now, I've taken it inside the printworks in this shot here. Now, this is a low light environment, and the camera copes really well in these conditions. It's, again, perhaps one of the better cameras, or maybe the best, that I've tested in these conditions. It doesn't introduce a lot of grain into the scene, but it managed to pull quite a lot of light. Looks really good. Now, to get a bit more excitement, I've taken it out in the car as well. First thing, I put it on top of the dashboard console thing where all the speedos and clocks and all that business are, just so that I've got it inside the car when I'm going out at night. So you can have a brief look at this nighttime footage here. And also, I just spoke to the camera for a little second while I was in the car so you can hear what the sound quality is like.
I'm driving along and it's quite quiet. I'll just do a little bit of a sound test to the camera.
So you might have heard from that the sound's a little bit muffled, a little bit quiet perhaps, and you might have noticed that on the street performance earlier on as well. The performance here in the low light environment of the car at night is very good. Of course, there's a lot of dash in the shot here, so in the next shot I put the camera in the back of the car facing out of the rear window. You see the lines across the heated elements on there. Now, this is a small camera, might be good as a dash cam, you'd think, but unfortunately it doesn't auto start and stop when it receives power. You'll have to turn it on manually and turn it off yourself, so not really ideal to use as a dash cam. However, it will loop over the memory card when it's full if you want it to. I'll show you that again later on in the menus. Now, I'll just show you briefly a few stills I took from the camera, supposed to be 6 megapixels. Here's one, so let's zoom in on that and have a look what the zoom looks like. So there you go, that's right in the middle, cropped out. And then we'll look at a video clip, and we've cropped out the center there. And if we compare the two, there's very little difference between them. So 6 megapixels, I don't believe it. I think it's just using stills out of the video. However, if you're looking at these being 2 megapixel stills taken from a 1920 by 1080 resolution sensor, then you know what, they look pretty good. Now, the magnet on the bottom is something that really seems to attract people's attention. I don't quite understand why, but I'll just mention a couple of things. You'll find as you go around, there's very little you can stick it to. I was walking all around town trying to stick it to everything, thinking I'll put it on this, use it as a tripod. Very little things that you see that look like metal are actually steel that a magnet will attach to. A lamppost, of course, is suitable, so I'll put it on there. There you go, that looks good, but of course that doesn't. Of course, that's what happens when you put the camera on something sideways. Now, you can get shots like this out of the camera, automatically rotating, and I'll show you what's going on. The camera has a sensor in it. I've switched it on underneath there, but I'm holding it on upside down. If I stick it on here, you can see that it's got it the right way up, because this camera's got its own orientation sensor in it. It will remember which way up it was when you switched it on, and it'll put the video that way up when you come to put it back into your computer or play it back later, so it orients the video the correct way up. Now I'll show you what happens if I take the camera off halfway along and then put it on the top. Notice the image is now upside down, even though the camera is the right way up. So it doesn't orient it midway through recording. To get the camera to reorient itself and record the video the right way up, you have to stop the camera from recording and then start it up again, and it notices that it's the other way up now, and the video will therefore follow the right way up. I hope I'm explaining this right. But basically, there's no mention of this orientation sensor, if that's a word, in the manual anyway. I've never seen anyone else mention it either. It's an interesting feature. So look, if I start the camera on its side and start it recording on its side like this, and then stick it to the side of this thing here, and we look at the video, now the video is the right way up, a bit slanted, so I'll just slide the camera a little bit further down. I could see it was a little bit off center there, so I'll just put it a little bit further down, but there you go. That's what happens, you get vertical video if you start the camera recording when it's on its side. So interesting little feature, having an orientation sensor built into the camera. Now when I was out testing it in Manchester, they were showing the new smart car. They had the left-hand drive models here. They're only coming out here next year sometime, and I was very happy to be able to test one of these out. You know, I like smart cars, or you might not do, but the people that I was that was demonstrating it while I was there were fascinated by the little camera I was filming with. They loved the fact it got a magnet on it. Everyone seems to love this magnet, even though it's really of very little use when you're out and about trying to stick the camera to things. There's very few things you'll find that the camera will stick to. I was hunting all around town to do those shots earlier on, just looking for anything that was magnetic or able to attach a magnet to. Anyway, I'm showing you the new smart car here, just to give you a bit of a brief look at this. I know you came looking at this video to look at the camera, but let's pretend that you're looking how the camera performs while I'm actually having a look at the new smart car. You know what, I really like these. I mean, that colour might be a little bit much. But anyway, here's my car, which coincidentally is also a smart car. Notice I'm trying to attach the magnet to, well, a cloth hood. That's not going to work, is it? So on my car, I'd have to put it there if I was to shoot sort of on top of the car. But of course, that's pointing too far down. Now, on most cars with a metal roof, put it in the middle there. You'll get all that part in the bottom of the shot. Remember when I had it in the dashboard and you got loads of dashboard in shot? Luckily, on my car, I can put it on this little bit here, made out of steel, and I can retract the roof. This is what it looks like with the roof in place. That's pretty much what it looked like with most cars if you stuck it on top of the roof. But I can retract this bit here, and now you can see my stupid bald head. So I took the camera out for a drive, and very shortly afterwards, the battery died just down the bottom of this road. But at least we got this little shot here. You can see me actually looking in the mirror there to see if it's still here, because this was the last shot I intended to do for this video. I did all the other stuff and then thought, right, if it falls off the car, it falls off. It doesn't matter. I've got all the other stuff, and I'll just mention it as a hilarious anecdote. But it did actually stay stuck to it. I was surprised. Now, here's an example of what happens if you drive towards the light. And notice the camera adjusts for the sky. The sky looks great, but it's not shooting the road. And now I've sort of tilted the car slightly down because we're going downhill now. And you see it's adjusted itself. So again, it's one of these cameras that really likes to be pointed in the right direction to get the light just right. Now, if you attach it up to a computer with that very useful little USB lead, you'll see that there's a couple of programs on here, one for the PC, Windows, and one for Mac OS 10. If you click into those, you'll see you get this this same thing. It's this little menu here. It lets you change the frequency between 50 and 60 hertz for the country that you're in, so that lights don't flicker when you film them. The timestamp you can switch on or off. The looping, the camera can cycle over its memory card when it's full and keep recording over and over. But remember, it doesn't have auto stop start, so it's not too much use that. You can sync the date and time off your computer onto the camera, and also you can adjust the volume of the beep the camera makes when you press the buttons or switch it off entirely. Now, as far as stats go, the video is recorded in 5-minute segments. Now, if you join all those together, they're seamless, but it's always 5 minutes. You can't adjust that. The format is MOV. Now, 5 minutes of 1080p 30 video takes up exactly 304.7 megabytes. And the reason it's exact is because the bitrate is fixed. In either 1080p 30 or 720p 30, it's 8.13 megabits a second, which is quite low for 1080p, really. Battery life, 85 or perhaps 90 minutes maybe at the most. And remember, it doesn't have an auto stop start feature. I keep mentioning that, so you can't really use this as a dash cam unless you want to manually stop and start the recording yourself. However, you can record and charge at the same time, so you can just keep recording forever and looping over the memory card. In fact, after a few hours use, I noticed that the magnet got very hot, so they're obviously using it as a heat sink, which makes sense really, and now I understand a little bit more why they've got a magnet on the bottom, just to get the heat out of the inside of the cube. Okay, let's sum up what we've learned about the Polaroid cube. The first thing is, I was quite impressed with the image quality, and the lens at 124 degrees seems about right. Obviously, not having a screen on it, you don't know exactly where you're pointing it, but 124 degrees is likely to get the object in shot that you're pointing at. The microphone, a little bit quiet, a little bit soft, not as good as it could be, but also not bad at all. The little LED on the top there, a little bit hard to see during the day, that little tiny LED, but actually the one button operation is the best one button operation I've ever come across on a device, so someone's obviously done a bit of thought into this. I like the fact you can get in the back here, but also it keeps it water resistant. Now, the only thing that I really don't like is the magnet, and it's the thing that everyone seems to be attracted to. I'm like, oh, it's got a magnet, yeah, brilliant, but you won't find hardly anything you can ever attach it to. You're always walking around thinking, what can I stick this to? And there's very few flat surfaces that you can stick a magnet on. You can put it on the side of the things, but then you end up with vertical video, of course, which is something we don't really want. If this was a tripod screw mount instead, just think of all the things you could attach it to just straight out of the box. You could put it to anything. I've got all sorts of things a tripod screw will attach to, very few things a magnet will attach to, and also as an action camera, I think it's going to fall off something and you're going to lose it, which is a bit of a shame. Slightly rubberized case, so I didn't mention that, so it's got a little bit of shock protection in it. But really, I want a tripod screw on this, and perhaps an optional magnet attachment that you can screw into it if you really want. Now, I know there's going to be people out there that say, why would you want a Polaroid cube for £100 when you can get the Mobius camera for £60? Well, I don't really know. Why would you do that? I mean, the Mobius camera is definitely more use to me and an awful lot of people. For one thing, you can use it as a dash cam. It will automatically start and stop. And yes, it doesn't have a magnet on the bottom of it. However, out of the box, you'll find that it does come with a little cradle that attaches on the bottom. And when you slide that in place, that gives you a little tripod screw mount, which means you can attach it to pretty much anything. But I'm pretty much preaching to people here that aren't going to listen, because people will just buy the Polaroid cube anyway because it looks cute and they like the magnet. One thing that might count in the cube's favour is the fact that it's going to have a full range of accessories available for it, including a proper waterproof case. And as long as these things don't rely on that magnet to attach to the camera, I think some of them might actually be pretty decent options. So to people in the know, they're probably better off sticking to their Mobius. But to the general public that don't know what a Mobius is and they buy a cube because it looked nice in the shops, well, they definitely haven't thrown their money away because it's still a pretty decent camera. Anyway, that's it for the moment. As always, thanks for watching.